Hello and welcome to the North American Invasive Species Management Association's monthly webinar series. My name is Elizabeth Brown and I'm the Professional Development Program Manager here at NASMA. I also serve to coordinate legislative affairs and the Certified Weed-Free Products Program. I am delighted to have you with us today for an outstanding lineup to launch the Western Governors Association's Data Mobilization Campaign for Invasive Species. NASMA has been a partner in this effort for a number of years, and I'm quite excited to learn more today from this outstanding group of experts we have lined up for you today. Before we begin, allow me just a quick moment to share a little bit about NASMA. Our mission is to support, promote, and empower invasive species prevention and management in North America. We are a 27-year-old organization that has many services and functions, including promoting international standards, the Certified Weed-Free Products Program, education and advocacy, save the date for National Invasive Species Awareness Week, February 22nd through 28th of 2021. We'll be largely virtual this year, more information to come. Outreach and awareness with our Play Clean Go campaign, professional development, and of course, our annual conference. Our virtual conference was in October, and we will have an option soon for those of you that were unable to join us to purchase the recordings at a discounted rate. Please save the date for next September. We hope to gather in person in Missoula, Montana, and just keep an eye on our webpage at nasma.org for more information about that. If you are not a member of NASMA, I encourage you to please explore our options. And I want to thank all of the folks that are here today that are members of NASMA. We sincerely appreciate and value each one of you. We have three different options for membership for individuals that you can learn about on our website. We also have four different partnership opportunities, and we can also create custom partnerships for your organization if you're interested. One of my favorite member benefits is our First Friday's event. The next one is January 8th. This is a networking hour for members only. And in January, we are going to be talking about advocacy. So again, our mission is to support, promote, and empower invasive species prevention and management in North America. Please check us out at our website if you're not familiar with us. And for everybody, you are always welcome to reach out to one of our staff members if you have questions or comments or input for us. Okay, so let's get to the main event, the Invasive Species Data Mobilization Campaign. Bill Whitacre will be moderating today's event. Bill is the Senior Policy Advisor with the Western Governors Association. You will hear from each of our panelists. We have Matt Neilson, a biologist with the U.S. Geological Survey, Lori Scott, CIO and VP for Products with NatureServe, our President of NASMA, Chuck Bargeron, from the University of Georgia Center for Invasive Species and Ecosystem Health, and Annie Simpson, biologist and data coordinator with the U.S. Geological Survey. With that, I'd like to introduce Bill Whitacre with the Western Governors Association. Again, we're so grateful that you're all here with us today. Thank you so very much. And Bill, I'm going to stop sharing and let you go ahead and share your screen.
Thank you, Elizabeth. I'll start my video here. So thank you, Elizabeth. Thank you for that very kind introduction. And thank you to NASMA for inviting WGA to take part in this and for just using your webinar series as an opportunity to launch the Invasive Species Data Mobilization Campaign. It's been great to work with NASMA over the years. And I think this Invasive Species Data Mobilization Campaign is a great example of some of the fruits of that effort. So I thank you again. So to introduce myself, as Elizabeth mentioned, I'm the Senior Policy Advisor at the Western Governors Association. I handle issues related to forest range management, forestry, grazing, and invasive species. And I'm here today particularly to talk about invasive species issues. So many of you may not know how the Western Governors Association operates. So I'm just gonna touch on that a little bit before we begin. So the Western Governors Association is a bipartisan organization where Western governors from the 22 westernmost states and territories come together to work on bipartisan issues and work across party lines for issues that are a priority to the West. And there's a number of issues that they work on and from a wide variety of, covering a wide variety of topics, but they've identified invasive species and invasive species data management as one of those priorities. WGA has a long history of work on invasive species. The Western Governors have, forest and range management has been a high priority for the Western Governors for a long time. And invasive species management is essentially inseparable from that issue, but our work on invasive species data management really started in 2017 when Western Governors formed an advisory group of an interagency advisory group of state, federal experts, as well as conservation groups, nonprofits, and private landowners and NGOs to come together to try to scope where Western Governors could use their leadership to help improve how invasive species are managed in the West. And so through a long scoping process, one thing we heard back was that there was really a need to, the one area where we focused was to improve how invasive species data is recorded, stored, and exchanged across the West. And that led to that same advisory group, many of those members, that led to WGA holding a invasive species data management workshop in Denver in March of 2018, where we had 27 member representatives from state and federal agencies, NGOs, industry, and other groups come together to discuss ways that invasive species data management could be improved in the West. And I just shared a link in the chat box to the product of that discussion. It's a set of findings and recommendations coming out of that meeting. It's a really interesting document. If you haven't seen it, I recommend that you look at it. We'll be referring to it throughout this conversation. But there's six key findings in that, but there's two of them that are really central to what we're here today to discuss that I'd like to go over. The first is that one of the findings and recommendations coming out of that was that, state and federal managers should be encouraged to utilize the four major data aggregators, so the major platforms, and we'll get to those later, using the NASMA mapping standard. So what does that mean? What is a mapping standard? That means when you are a person is out in the world and discovers an invasive species in whatever capacity, the mapping standard is how they record what they found using some basic fields, things like location, species, who's recording it, et cetera, how those are stored in, how those are stored electronically, and then how those are shared to other invasive species managers. That is the standard, and there are, that was one of the key findings of the group, is that it's really important that the goal of invasive species management is to stop the spread of invasive species at a wide, across the landscape. And to do that, you have to know where the species are, where they aren't, where your neighbors might have species, invasive species, or where they don't. So you need to know where the threats are. And to do that, everyone has to be speaking the same language about invasive species data. And so to that end, it's really important that everybody uses the same standard. So that was a real step forward to encourage everyone to use the same standard. And we've got experts on that standard, far more expert than I am, who will be talking later about that. So that's the first phase. The second phase is that once you have it recorded in a way, a format or a standard that it is that everyone can read and meets the minimum basic standards, it is important to share that data with in a way that it can be that other managers can find that data. So that is using one of the major invasive species data integration platforms that are available. There's four major ones in the country, and there are four groups, or there are four representatives here to represent, to discuss each one of those. So we'll get into those at greater length. But the concept behind this is, if you're sharing your, recording your data in a standard method, and you're sharing it on one of these data aggregators, these data integrators work together, and then that sort of guarantees that if you are interested in learning, or if you're interested in sharing your data, that will guarantee that data is accessible to other land managers on the other side of the fence who might be able to help with that. So that was those are the key findings in 2018 that were the product of that discussion. Shortly after that, Governor David Ige of Hawaii became the chair of the Western Governors Association. And as chair, he had the option to focus a large measure of the association's attention on a specific issue, and he chose to spend a year focused on biosecurity and invasive species and launched a biosecurity and invasive species campaign from 2018 to 2019. And if you're not familiar, I encourage you to go to the Western Governors Association website. There's a report that came out of that, a lot of great information there. Too much to get into now, a lot of really good stuff. I'd recommend you to that you look at that. And then there's another thing that I recommend that came out at the end of the initiative was a new policy resolution from the Whitacre governors on biosecurity and invasive species. Again, if you haven't seen that, I really recommend that you do. There's a lot of good stuff in there. But there's one key item in that I'd like to discuss today, and that is that in that, Western governors make it their policy, or state that their policy is that, and I'll read it verbatim, accurate, standardized, and accessible geospatial data is essential to biosecurity and invasive species management in the West. Western governors support efforts to standardize and centralize invasive species occurrence data, streamline the exchange of data between the nation's invasive species data aggregators, and increase the accessibility of data to federal, state, and local land resource managers. So that really gives us the charge that we're here today is to, the Western governors are have identified this as a priority and interested in using their leadership and their profile to get the word out on the importance of invasive species management and encourage data management and encouraging folks to share and standardize their data. So that's what we're doing here today is we're launching a year-long campaign on invasive species data management. So there's some real key parties to this. So first is that there's the data integrators, those four main groups that manage the platforms where data is able to be shared. We'll be hearing from them later. We really appreciate that, their work up to this point and then their participation on this panel. Second are the campaign cooperators. So that is on the slide, you see that list of cooperators there, and those are groups that organizations that work on invasive species issues and groups that just really understand that the importance that good data makes to good decision making in invasive species issues. So as cooperators, they're helping us to highlight the importance of this issue, and they're encouraging people in their networks to standardize and share invasive species data. I just want to let everyone know that the cooperators are really grateful for your help with this and your enthusiasm about what we're trying to do here. And we really look forward to working with you over the coming year. And then the third group is the third key to this campaign is everybody in the West who works on invasive species data issues. That is who this campaign is designed for, anybody who potentially works on data. That's, federal agencies, state agencies, local groups, conservation districts, private landowners, citizen scientists, anybody who is concerned about land and invasive species management. We are trying to, in the course of the next year, reach out to them and start a conversation about the importance of invasive species data and encourage people to look at how they are recording their data and how they are sharing their data and how other groups might be using the data and look at what perhaps the barriers are to the sharing of that data and to, as they can, help standardize and share in data and as they can to help remove any of the barriers to that data sharing. And we're accomplishing this through ongoing work with the cooperators on this process. We're doing this through, you'll be seeing monthly media from WGA on podcasts and case studies and examples of where good data led to good decision-making. So we're gonna foster a year-long conversation on how this is important. And at the results of this, we're really at the end of this process, we're looking, this whole effort should make life easier for everybody who's working on these issues. Any land manager who needs to use data and who needs to share data and just really to improve how we understand the threat of invasive species in the West and also to help those working to manage it to help form better management practices. So that's really what we're trying to accomplish over the next year. I'm sure there's a lot of questions about how this works, so we're really looking to spend the remainder of this conversation talking about answering those questions. So with this, I'm going to turn it to, we've got four experts on invasive species data management from those integrating groups, those data integrators. We'll start with them, and then I'm going to then turn to be the moderator, and we'll have some moderated questions, and then we'll open Q&A. So I'm hoping that we answer all your questions about how this works. I'm hoping that you get involved, and then please submit any questions to the Q&A function, and it looks like that's already happening, so I appreciate that. So with that, I will turn things over to Matt Neilson, the fishery biologist with the U.S. Geological Survey.
Bill, appreciate the time today, and thanks to NASMA for having us on this moderated webinar. So I work with the U.S. Geological Survey's Non-Indigenous Aquatic Species Database Program, and essentially our goal is to track things that live in the water anywhere they're not supposed to, anywhere in the United States. So our program is a central repository for spatially referenced, expertly reviewed accounts of introduced aquatic species. Currently, our program tracks over 1,300 different aquatic species across the U.S., and the database includes close to 630,000 observations. We track things across the conterminous U.S., so the lower 48 states, Alaska, Hawaii, and all of the associated U.S. territories, including Puerto Rico, U.S. Virgin Islands, and Guam. Our data dates back from the early 1800s all the way up to the present day. Primarily, we focus on most macroscopic taxa and things that include obligate aquatic species. So any sort of organism that requires water for some portion of its life cycle are the things that we generally try to track. Now you can see our URL for the database and the website down at the bottom of your screen as well. Next slide, please, Bill. So our program contains a number of different components. The primary component is our distribution maps of these observation data, which include both the historical and the current occurrence data, native ranges for North American native taxa, animated invasion time series maps, so you can look at the spread of the species over time. We also allow for some custom spatial queries and analyses directly on our maps as well. We also include species profiles, which are an informative summary on taxonomy, native range, distribution, means of introduction, pathways of introduction, and species biology, any species impacts, status, and a short literature synthesis. Data sources for the database, we get data from museum collection databases, other federal and state natural resource management agencies, academic researchers, the primary academic literature, as well as the news literature. We also take in citizen science data as well. We also have a couple of different actionable tools that are useful for invasive species management. These include a species alert system, which provides push notifications for new records within the database, either for a specific taxon or a specific area of interest. We also do some qualitative risk analyses looking at the potential area of that's under threat of introduction following a new occurrence, which looks at species biology and any sort of watershed characteristics to try to identify where you might want to look for a species after an introduction in one particular place as well. We have some tools including looks at the spread of species following hurricanes. So that uses storm-associated and storm surge and rainfall flooding to look at potential distribution species as well. We also have some tools for biosurveillance and for screening of data sets for any records of non-indigenous aquatic species as well. So again, NAS database, we generally focus on aquatic species anywhere in the United States. Thank you.
Thank you, Matt. And next up, we have Lori Scott, the Vice President for Products at NatureServe, to discuss IMAP invasives.
Thank you, Bill. Thanks to NASMA for the opportunity. I work with NatureServe, which is a nonprofit that partners with jurisdictions across U.S., Canada, Latin America, and we coordinate the IMAP invasives partnership. IMAP Invasives is designed to enter, manage, and share invasive species information, including presence records, treatment efforts and effectiveness, and areas where invasive species were searched, including where they were not found. So both absence and presence data. IMAP Invasives allows you to generate custom distribution maps and also to configure email alerts to support early detection. You can filter, export, and report information to inform regulatory decisions, rapid response efforts. IMAP Invasives is worked closely with partners in jurisdictions where most of these decisions can get made, and so jurisdictions can customize the IMAP Invasives platform by selecting what species they're tracking, setting user roles and permissions, creating early detection networks by configuring those custom email alerts for approaching species and other state and province specific customizations. So IMAP Invasives is available for anyone to use anywhere in the Americas with a free account. Data can be collected for plants, animals, or pathogens on land or in the water. So multi-taxa, multi-habitat. And then data can be shared across jurisdictional boundaries, as you can see on the map here. Built-in advanced reporting tools allow you to make a list of which species are present or not present yet, but approaching for any geography. There's also an infested area report that will estimate coverage by species using the latest data in the system. Users can also generate custom distribution maps on the fly. Data entry is done through bulk upload, through online entry using the application's mobile responsive browser interface when in cell phone range, or we have mobile applications available for both Apple and Android, as well as an Esri Survey 123 mobile app that can be used when you're not in connectivity. The IMAP Invasives Network is a collaborative partnership of states and provinces, with each jurisdiction having an IMAP Invasives Administrator who defines their state's track species list, incorporates bulk uploads of data, recruits and trains users, including citizen science groups, and coordinates user permissions for roles like confirming presence records. These admins also guide the development priorities for the IMAP Invasives platform. So it's truly a shared system that gets improved through everyone's combined input and feedback. Active states with administrators in the Western region, part of the WGA region, are Arizona and Oregon. IMAP Invasives confirmed presence records are publicly available through web services and available for download. That makes it easy to share data with other invasive species data management systems. Currently, we are sharing and exchanging data between IMAP and other systems in different ways. We've provided a full data export from IMAP to Bison about 6 months ago, and we are coordinating data sharing in both directions with the other data providers on this webinar. We would like to coordinate data sharing with these groups using web services and APIs, and we've begun doing that coordination in more detail with USGS, the NAS system that Matt just described. So I guess I'll leave it with that. This visual that you can see on the slide just gives you a snapshot of the statistics of the data in IMAP Invasives currently by type of record, by habitat type, by jurisdiction, by data entry method, and by kingdom, as well as the top reported species. Thank you very much. And the URL is at the top right, imapinvasives.org. Thank you.
Thank you, Lori. That was great. And then up next, we have Chuck Bargeron, the co-director at the Center for Invasive Species and Ecosystem Health at the University of Georgia, for more info on EdMaps.
Thanks, Bill, and everybody else. So EdMaps was really built to address two needs. And one was having a way to do electronic early detection and then integration of data into one standardized platform. So, you know, when I think about EdMaps, when I talk about EdMaps, we're looking at it as this platform, both to help people report things and get those reports to the right people, which is built using a national network of verifiers, and then, you know, different ways for that information to get in. And so whether that be smartphone apps, web interface, bulk data, whether it be data going through iNaturalist and then uploaded into EdMaps. The mission, the goal, and the purpose of EdMaps is to pull all that together and make it as easy as possible for the user. We've really looked into better ways of doing that in the last few years, and that has led to tools like EdMaps Pro for people that are reporting hundreds of records a day and also doing follow-up treatments and kind of status changes on the data over time. And then very simple tools like I've Got One or Wild Spotter focused directly on citizen scientists. And all of that said has led to EdMaps growing to over 5 million invasive species records, covering about 5,000 different species, contributions from about 25,000 different individuals, as well as sources and a registration of membership of over 100,000 individuals as well. EdMaps has averaged about 346 records coming in every single day over the past year. We are, all the data is publicly available to be downloaded in different formats and to be shared. And we're expanding to include all of Canada within the next few months. We're already working in Alberta and Ontario. Just a few other things I want to point out. EdMaps is possible because of different partnerships, and I've included some of our partners and funding sources over the last 15 years that EdMaps has been going, with the logos on the bottom. And those partnerships, that integrating EdMaps into the educational campaign, into the outreach campaign, is really what's important. Other things, the slide similar to what Lori showed of just kind of where the distribution of data in EdMaps is across the US. And then just kind of the philosophy, and recently the term fair data standard has been something that is talked about when you're talking about sharing data. So we originally talked about this slide with some different verbs there and descriptors there, and now that's changed to really thinking about everything you do with data to be able to make that data be easily findable, easily accessible, interoperable, shareable with different systems, and then reusable, whether it's for modeling or analysis beyond that. So yeah, so that's EdMaps.
Thank you, Chuck. Appreciate that. And then finally, we have Annie Simpson, a biologist and information scientist with the U.S. Geological Survey, to talk about USGS bison.
Thank you, Bill. The USGS Biodiversity Information Serving Our Nation, or BISON, application is an all species mapping application on the web. Because we treat our species equanimously, all of the US, its territories, and Canada are included. And because it is all species, not just invasive species, that are in BISON, we are the largest data integrator of the four applications that are being described to you today. BISON currently includes 464 million records. There are 176 million of those records that are from US states west of the Mississippi. Most of those records come from GBIF, the Global Biodiversity Information Facility. BISON is currently completing a data load that will increase our size by 25%, hopefully by mid-January. We do emphasize federal data sets, invasive species data sets, and pollinator species data sets. Our inclusion of all species enables users to more easily model interactions among invasive species and nearby native species. Many invasive species occurrences are included in data sets without actually being labeled as invasive or non-native. So those data can be considered somewhat hidden. So that hidden data within the BISON application is tagged using the USGS non-native species list. And so that data becomes more readily available for use by invasive species scientists. Another feature of BISON is that a species search can, if the user chooses, be optimized by the Integrated Taxonomic Information System, or ITIS. So biologists know that the accepted name or valid name of a species can change more than once over time. So the ITIS taxonomic backbone in BISON groups all of the known scientific names for a species so that a search that is ITIS enabled for one scientific name, whether it's the current name or an old name, it will bring up a result that has all of the records for that name and the records for all of the synonyms, all of the known synonyms. So I have to be sure to let you know of various things that BISON doesn't do. we do not directly receive citizen science data. We do not have frequent updates, but we're working to change that. Updates can take a year. We do not have a modern interface because we went online in 2012, and we are working to update that interface. Our backend is a solar query API that's quite powerful. And finally, I'd like to talk to you briefly about our take on data mobilization. So we believe that data should be freely shared in a standardized format. As Chuck has mentioned, the FAIR data principles are important. We also really fully support the Western Governors Association Invasive Species Data Campaign. And we are actively working with the information systems that have been described to you today to improve data mobilization in the West and everywhere. Please share your data. We do this by following what is called the FAIR data principles. And as Chuck has said, by contributing your data to a data integrator, such as one of ours, you will automatically make your data more findable and accessible. By following data standards that have been described by Bill and by Chuck and by others, your data becomes interoperable. And finally, by following best practices for data collection, your shared data becomes reusable. We hope that you will join us in promoting the WGA Invasive Species Data Mobilization Campaign in every way that you can. Thank you.
Thank you, Annie. That was great. I really appreciate it. And I really appreciate everyone's presentation. It was great to hear from all the four major data integrators. And I appreciate everyone in the audience for getting a lot of really good questions. I appreciate the enthusiasm there. So I've got a couple questions I want to ask the panelists. And then I'm going to save plenty of time to answer some of the questions that are coming in from the audience members. I'll start off with the first question. Why is it important for land managers to standardize and share invasive species data? And using the term land manager, very broad definition of that term to include groups from folks from all different levels. Why is it important? Why, if someone has a system now that doesn't utilize the standards and doesn't utilize a major data integration platform, why would they want to change? Why would changing the way they do things help land managers at large in the region and in the country? And I'll turn it over to the panelists if anyone wants to jump ahead with that. And if not, I'll start calling on folks.
Well, Bill, I'll at least throw something in here with that. I mean, the likelihood is if you are collecting invasive species data, you're probably not that far from what the standard is, because anybody that's collecting data needs to know what it is, who took the data, when they took it, where they took it, and why they took it. And those are really the, and maybe I left Wynn, I think I'll include Wynn. And those are really the driving force behind the standards, is some of the little details to make sure that if we all are talking the same language, then when you combine all the data and then you can make assumptions on it and make decisions based on it. So, you know, in a lot of cases, if you're collecting data, you're collecting stuff that would work with the standards. It's just maybe naming things a little different just to kind of make it easier to combine it.
Thank you, Chuck. Any other panelists have any thoughts on that?
I agree with it. The basic observation fields are pretty minimal, the who, what, when, where kind of things. And we all have, I think, a process to crosswalk from other formats into the standards that we use in our respective systems and to be able to share data across them. So thank you.
Thanks, Lori. Any other thoughts on that? Okay, I've got a question. I think this, and this applies to, I think, all the panelists too. There have been some questions in the chat about, so there are four, we have featured four data integrators today, sort of the big four data integrators. Beyond that, what are some of the other invasive species data management platforms, and how do you integrate, or how do you communicate your platforms, communicate with those groups?
I mean, three that immediately come to mind in the West would be the Lady Bird Johnson Wildflower Center has a very good program that's run over the years that they manage in-house, and then that data is shared. There's the AcEpic database in Alaska, where it's a state-level database that shares out with others. And then CalFlora, California Invasive Plant Council, has been working with CalFlora to map data in California, specifically of invasive plants, and that data is shared as well. And then you also have all the agency-specific data sets that where U.S. Forest Service, BLM, National Park Service all collect invasive species data along with other activities. And BLM, that data is usually pretty available and shared through one of the platforms represented here.
Okay. Any other thoughts on that question?
Bill, I'd like to confess a debility that I have ADD. It would really be helpful if you would briefly repeat or summarize questions more than once.
Absolutely. Happy to do that, Annie. So the question I was asking is, beyond the big four data, the major data integrators that we have here on the webinar now, what are some other invasive species data management platforms that people might be using? And how does that interface with bison, say?
There are several. I can come up with a few beyond the big four. I know of texasinvasives.org in the West. There are several federal data systems like the BLM National Invasive Species Information Management System, and NPS also has one. Those are generally not freely available online, but they make their data available through bison. There is Nemesis, the Smithsonian's National Exotic and Marine Estuary and Species Information System, that is online and emphasizes marine species, and they do it very well. Then, of course, there's the Midwest Invasive Plant Network, and many botanists have used the NRCS plants database to help them locate at the, I think it's county level, non-native species that are plants. There are so many that are at the protected area, county and regional level that are digitized, but password protected. And we are really trying to encourage people to share that data.
Great, thank you, Annie. Well, I'm going to shift a little earlier to answering questions from the audience. We're getting a lot of good audience participation. So I'm going to start with that, and then we'll get back to those other questions. But if the moderated questions, if there's time and need at the end. So there's a question on, do you ask for the reporting? This is for Mark. Do you ask for the reporting discovering a new potential biological control on an invasive species? So this is, I think it's worth emphasizing that this campaign is directed towards invasive species occurrence data. There have been discussions about, throughout the years planning on this, things including biological control, treatments, how to record treatments, best management practices, things like that. That's outside of the scope of what we're trying to do with this. We're focusing on invasive species occurrence data. And then I know there are other platforms for that. If any of the panelists, I'll pause for a moment if any of the panelists have any advice on that. Okay, hearing none. So here's a question from Angie and then she noted that it was kind of answered, but I think this is worth just discussing too, because this is sort of at the core of the concept of what we're trying to do. I guess this question is probably for Lori and Chuck specifically. Does IMAP invasives work with EdMaps and other platforms? One of the issues I think managers like myself are having now is having so many options for reporting that it is hard to get all of your data into one place. And then I think I will just I'll start with that. And then I'm interested to hear from Lori and Chuck is that I think, there's been so much work done and conversations had and over the years about, and I've been a party of some of that is to, really making sure that there's so much communication going on between these platforms that we are confident, and that's part of the principles at the core of this campaign is that if you, there's so much data sharing going on between these four platforms that if you enter into one, it will be available on the other platforms at some point. And I think that's sort of at the heart of this too, is to try to eliminate redundancy of entering and along those lines. But Lori, Chuck, I hope I didn't misrepresent that. Or do you have something to add to that?
I'll just say with IMAP Invasives, the current version, we did emphasize trying to make it easy for data to be shared through web services. And so we have been, I did partially answer this in one of the chats and in the remarks that I made. You know, we have been coordinating with the different systems. We have a way to, like, we have a public REST endpoint for our web service, so if other systems could integrate that, they'd be able to view the IMAP data alongside the other systems data and vice versa. So that is a goal that we've been striving for, so that we would help reduce the redundancy of having data entered in multiple systems, like, and ending up with duplication. When that does happen, we also have a way, there are parts of the data standard that allow you to kind of tie the record back to the source, so you could not double count it, if you will. But all of the systems aren't yet fully set up for that flowing of real-time data. That's the end goal, I think, in the case of IMAP, and Chuck can speak for EdMaps.
Yeah, I mean, absolutely, that what we've been talking about through this entire process is figuring out ways that all of our systems can talk to each other. And so you choose what platform works best for you. And there's differences between them. There's pros and cons in terms of what different ones can do. And then the data goes in and it's automatically shared, at least at some point, with other groups. And so, you know, I'll give a great example. You know, the USGS NAS folks are all in EdMaps as verifiers. And so when a report goes into EdMaps, they're automatically alerted immediately to that report. And so those kind of ways of doing things, you know, we have to figure out what level of verification our partners are comfortable with. And that really comes down to one of the issues is, you know, we can pull in all the iNaturalist data into any of our systems, but just because it's research grade on iNaturalist does not mean that a state weed coordinator in the Western state is going to be comfortable with that data showing up as being in their state. And that even gets more complicated when you talk about some of the more regulatory issues and data for insects and diseases that have regulatory concern, like what's in NAPIS. The hope is that by integrating the data from a system like iNaturalist, that we can find those new occurrences of things that people really do care about, and then that gets shared between the systems. So, you know, being able to integrate all the data is where we need to be. The technology part's not that difficult. It's just figuring out, okay, what data gets shared where, and what data gets automatically shown on a map versus what data has to go through a review process before it's shown on the individual system's map. And I think that's held us back a little bit, some of those details.
Any other thoughts on that? Okay, hearing none. Here's a question for Matt, and then with Elizabeth Brown. I think this could, I'd be curious, feel free to let us know if you've got any thoughts on this as well, but because I know you've got a lot of expertise in this area. Are any of these platforms hosting or able to host data from the invasive species inspection stations operating in many Western states?
We currently do not host any of the data directly from the inspection stations. We have been working with partners to potentially get data from this, working with the watercraft inspection database to do this. We primarily are looking at data within open waters, within NAS, so it's not necessarily looking directly at things attached to moving vehicles that are being come across on inspection stations. So NAS currently does not, but that is something we could definitely explore in the future. Wes, would you like to answer that as well?
I think you covered it well. We also focus a lot of our efforts on wild populations. And although that information is informative to think about what is being transported between lakes, those would be identified as failed introductions, obviously, because they were stopped, which is great news. Before Elizabeth took her new position, we were in conversation with her about the watercraft inspection database and hosting some of that. And I hope that we can continue that discussion into the future.
Yeah, I'll just echo what Matt and Wes said. The watercraft inspection and decontamination database is not hosting species information. It's hosting data associated with boat inspections and decontaminations, which could include species found on a watercraft during an inspection and then decontaminated depending on the jurisdiction. And so, but the focus of that is more on the boats than the species. So it's a little bit different, but that is now shared by 12 Western states, I think we're up to. Forgive me if I'm off there, but I think we're at 12 and federal agencies and local governments and NGOs and private industry. So certainly something to continue the discussion on. Yeah.
Thank you. Thank you, Elizabeth. And thank you, Matt and Wes. So we've got two questions about the role of citizen science in all of this. So Lori, they're both directed towards you. I'm going to read them sort of back to back because I think there's the related questions. One is, does invasive species data from iNaturalist get uploaded to IMAP invasives? And then the second question is, which reporting system do you recommend? This is directly for Laura. Which reporting system do you recommend for community science organizations to alleviate duplicate reporting? Or we are in Oregon and use iNaturalist Oregon Invasive Species Online Hotline, but are aware of IMAP invasives and WildSpotter. So those are two related questions to you, Laura. Lori, pardon me.
Thanks. So with iNaturalist, what Chuck mentioned earlier, there's a couple of avenues. So in the states where we have these active administrators, like in Oregon, our partners there are routinely integrating in vetted iNaturalist data. So we have that additional step of having a state administrator who can curate and confirm and bring in that sort of data that passes that certain level of research grade, as well as being able to confirm it. We have also been we've been moving in the direction of, on a national level, also bringing in iNaturalist data through NatureServe, coordinating and helping fill in those gaps where we don't have active state cooperators filling that role. So that's in progress. But there would also be, you know, to the second part of the question that you asked, Bill, like, as the different maps show, there's activity in different states at different levels in these systems. So it's also quite likely that iNaturalist data, if entered in other states, could be flowing through into the other systems, including EdMaps. So it's, I think the mantra should be not to worry that your data won't get taken up, that it's probably going to get in one or more of these systems. And we're also actively trying to promote the data sharing across all of them so that we can get the fullest picture across the country of which invasives are coming and where.
Great. Thank you, Lori. And then this is another question, and sort of in the spirit of citizen science, because I know that certain apps work this way, are there any efforts to integrate some image recognition into these mapping systems, something like Google Lens or PlantNet, if I'm pronouncing that correctly, that can ID a species with a cell phone, camera, algorithm, then report mapping information to a system? Does anyone want to jump in on that one?
I can say just a little bit. I'm not really highly qualified on this, but we are all working towards that. But as a data integrator, rather than, we don't accept data directly from citizen science. So as a data integrator, we would depend on other species, other data systems to do that AI work and vet those images. I think the most famous example on that one is iNaturalist. They are image-based. And when a user goes into that system, they put in a picture and there are suggestions on what those could be. Their vetting is, what's that called? Crowd-based. So once the AI kicks in and something is chosen, other people where the image is good enough quality add their expertise on identification. But there's been great advances in apps that will provide the common user, someone who just wants to know, okay, is that a maple or not? You know, the leaf snap, for example, you can take a picture and it'll give you pretty good idea on what group of trees that, or even sometimes species they came from. And there are always improvements happening. We look forward to those improvements. And as data integrators, sharing the fruits of those improvements.
And to follow on what Annie said, you know, we are a relatively small team, so we don't necessarily have the development capacity to work on deep learning and machine learning for image recognition. We do, however, rely on programs that have expertise like iNaturalist, which does have that capability.
Thank you, Matt. So I've got time for one very quick question, then this will be Annie and Chuck brief answers. So I think this is a good example, this question, about what the sort of thinking we're trying to encourage with this campaign, with the campaign. So I think this is an example of success here, is that just a common question from Robert, that I'm trying to decide which integrator system to recommend to the National Wildlife Refuge system. I've struggled between bison and EdMaps because EdMaps has certain invasive species data fields available, such as abundance, percent cover, treated versus non-treated, that bison does not. It seems like it might be a better choice. But I also appreciate bison's focus on federal and invasive species. Are there other things that might be considered? If the integrators are all sharing data amongst each other, does it matter? Annie and Chuck, just in about 2 minutes, do you want to address that?
I mean, the only thing I would say is if you're looking for a place to archive your data versus a data entry platform, you know, as Annie just said, there's not an app for bison. And so if you're looking at a way to archive the National Wildlife System, Refuge System data, then whether it goes into bison or whether it goes into EdMaps doesn't make a lot of difference. If you're talking about a tool for the managers to use on the ground, then using EdMaps or IMAP Invasives would be probably the way you'd want to go if you're looking at all taxa. So, but others chime in.
Yeah, there was a similar question in one of the chats about sort of differentiating among sort of data management tools versus sort of an archive, upload, aggregation, and integration. So there are differences among the systems in that regard. Sorry, I think Annie was about to speak. I apologize.
Oh, that's okay. That's okay. Did you finish?
I did. Yep.
So bison accepts direct data sets largely from federal sources, from invasive species data sets, and from pollinator data owners as well. We refer people all the time to other data solutions, because what we are really trying to do is try to get as much data as possible available to as many people as possible. And USGS is actually the US node to the Global Biodiversity Information Facility, which offers more than 1 billion points, not in the US, but around the world, of species occurrence data, invasive and non-invasive. And so I don't think there's a problem with just pick a system, any system, and share it, and you will be doing a good thing.
Thanks, Annie. And I think that's a great way to end it. I mean, here are the four largest systems in the country working together to try to, you know, sharing data, working together to encourage other folks to just use a system. And, you know, they're working hard to make sure that there's sharing between them. And I think that's, you know, it's structured so that it's one of these systems. If it gets entered into one, the data will eventually be available on all of them. So with that, I thank everyone for the time, and I thank NASMA for hosting, and I'll pass it off to, I don't want to end things yet, I'll pass things off to Elizabeth.
Okay, thank you so much. Just a quick note on behalf of everyone at NASMA, many thanks to all of our panelists and presenters today, Bill Whitaker and Emma Heth behind the scenes, and everyone at Western Governors Association. We appreciate you being here and sharing this invaluable information with us today. All of the attendees will receive a post-webinar survey. We sincerely appreciate if you could take that survey and help to inform our future webinar series. And if you are seeking continuing education credits, that's critical that you take that survey. We all wish you a very safe and healthy and happy new year. Save the date. Our first Friday will actually be on the second Friday because the first Friday is New Year's Day. So January 8th will be our first Friday. Our next webinar is January 20th. We look forward to seeing you in 2021.